Hello, you're watching a tutorial video for Shogun 2 Total War Fall of the Samurai. Pretty much it's the same thing as that I did for vanilla Shogun 2 Total War without Fall of the Samurai, except this is geared towards the Fall of the Samurai expansion. If you don't have the Fall of the Samurai expansion, you can watch the old tutorials I did for Shogun 2 Total War. They would still be relevant to you then, for the most part, except the parts that involve fighting Fall of the Samurai armies, obviously. I'd made a previous video, another tutorial for Fall of the Samurai, which covered the basic topics. This is going to cover the more advanced topics, so I'm going to assume you'd already seen the basic one, or you already knew the gist of everything in the basic video, so you just skipped out on it. This is going to cover some more of the more advanced topics. Pretty much I'm going to cover in more detail about the retainers. I'm going to go into more detail about how to upgrade the skill tree when you have all 20 points to spend. And the main gist of it will be going over how to upgrade your veteran units properly, or in my opinion, how to properly upgrade them. So let's start with the retainers. In the basic video, I'd gone over, you know, the gist of this right here, the best retainers that you can get from the clan map, which pretty much I said, Bandit Horse Thieves, -5 charge to all enemy cavalry, the Armor Bearer, +4, oh, that's the wrong one actually. That's a random drop. The Standard Bearer, +3 morale to your avatar. And Practice Grounds, which is probably the best of them all, +2 attack to all cavalry units. And I'd actually forgotten to mention this one. This is another decent one. I'd say in order of importance, Practice Grounds the best one. Bandit Horse Thieves and Standard Bearer would probably come next, and then this would probably be the fourth best out of the ones you can unlock from the Avatar Conquest map, which is Yumebushi Guide. All units have a reduced fatigue gain and -20% to speed penalties when crossing rough terrain like hills or rivers and stuff like that. And there's some other ones that you can put up with. I discussed them in the basics video. You know, other retainers that affect things like fatigue resistance of specific troops, either yours or your enemies, or things that affect speed, like, you know, right here, Horse Trader, +5% speed to cavalry. There's other things you can put up with, or maybe Famous Armory if you have a lot of melee troops. There's other retainers that you can unlock from the Conquest map that you can put up with. They're not that great, though. These are the best out of the ones you can unlock from the Conquest map, though, right here. Now there's other retainers, random drop retainers, which you really have no effect on how you get them. You'll get them when you get them. If you're lucky, you'll get them soon. If you're not lucky, it'll take you ages before you get them. Out of the random drops, there's three good ones, and I have two of them. One of them is Blademaster, which is +2 attack to all sword infantry. The other one is Flogging Officer, which is -1 morale to all enemy line and elite infantry. And the third one is Von Clausewitz on War, which is +1 morale to all line and elite infantry units. So those are the best out of the random drops. And you should use some formula of those retainers I just discussed as your set of five retainers when you play. As far as the skill tree is concerned, now in the basics video I discussed the best place to put your first couple points to have the most effect right away. In this video I'm going to assume you already have all 20 points to spend, though, and this is the best way to upgrade your skill tree with all 20 points. Now sometimes I use a hybrid between the three, and I'll show you how to do that, but on a whole, you're usually best off putting all 20 of your points in one tree, which will enable you to get, you know, the last upgrade in each tree. Well, basically, let's go over the leadership, the command tree first. The best traits in this command tree are improved aura, which gives a wider radius, aura radius around your general, which anything inside that aura radius has, you know, like morale, and it helps their morale and other stuff. So this makes that radius wider. And so elite units sort of do a similar thing. They affect units within the radius of the elite unit. And elite units are things like Shogunate Guard Cavalry, Marine Gun Units, things like that. And second in command will make that aura radius around the unit even wider. So it'll affect even more surrounding units. Both of those are good. Other good things in this tree are stand and fight, which you'll put your general into stand and fight. He won't be able to move. You won't be able to give him any commands. He'll dismount and go into a little square formation. And when this is activated, it'll help the morale, attack, and reload rate of units within its aura radius, and also make the aura radius even wider when he's in stand and fight. And probably the best one out of this tree is increased army morale, which will give one morale to all units in your army. Some other ones that are decently good are rapid capture. You know, you can capture dojos quicker. I suppose quick march is pretty good, makes your units move quicker. Scouting's decent, I guess. You know, you can expose hidden units from a greater distance. And bombardment's good too, the last one. It's not as good as people think it is, though. You'll do some damage. It won't do as great of a damage. I suppose if the enemy's units are blobbed when you hit him and you target it just right, it might do a, you know, decent amount of damage, but it's not the greatest. But even still, you're probably best, you know, getting that bombardment. If you're going to go for the command tree, you're better off just getting that, because... Alright, let's see. You want to work up to increased army morale and stand and fight. You would need to do something like... that, which would leave you with 6 points left to spend. Oh, and reconnaissance is good too. It would allow you to see your enemy units before the battle starts. I don't use it too much. When I have a full command tree, you might as well use it though. Alright, so this you worked up. This is what you need to have 14 points spent in order to get increased army morale, stand and fight, which is the best of the leadership, the command tree. Where are you going to put those other 6 points? You can get some extra attack and defense for your avatar from this Bushido tree, or you can enable its gun and get some extra reload and accuracy for your avatar from the gun tree. But if you think about it, you're going to be utilizing stand and fight, and you can't give your general orders when he's in stand and fight. He doesn't do anything. He just stays immobile, stationary, and you know helps this gives a bonus to the surrounding units. So if you're using this, you're not even going to be using your general, so you're better off just going ahead and fully upgrading him and giving him bombardment, which is an ability that allows you to call in a naval bombardment, which will strike a certain area and do some damage. Now, if you're going to do the Bushido tree, the best things in the Bushido tree are, let's see, Bushido morale, extra morale, all melee units in your army. Bushido charge, extra charge, all melee units in your army. Cavalry capture, which means you can capture dojos with mounted cavalry, which comes in really handy. And then cooperative capture, which means you can put multiple units on one dojo and capture it even quicker. Last man standing is also good. Your general will always be the last man in its unit to die, so if you get hit with an artillery strike, your general won't die from it. It'll be the last person in your bodyguard to die, so comes in handy too. And obviously heroic assault, when you use this ability, it'll give extra morale, stamina, and speed to all units in your army, so that will come in handy. And there's some other good ones too, I suppose. You know, double time cavalry and infantry makes your units quicker. And obviously just like attack, defense, and armor, and, you know, for your general would come in handy too, although you're going to try to keep your general safe usually, so you're probably, you know, not going to use it to its full stability because you're better off trying to keep your gen safe. But if you have a full Bushido tree, you're going to end up using your general in melee at some point in the battle, or at least you benefit from it. But in general, you want to keep him safe, no matter, even if he is a Bushido tree, because you want to keep your general safe, usually. Because as soon as your general dies, you lose all these abilities, you know. You know, you lose the morale, and the, you know, you lose this stuff when he dies, so you want to keep him safe. If you're doing a gun tree, I really don't use this that much, because the best things in the gun tree, though, reload line infantry, which will improve the reload of your line infantry. It'll only improve the reload by +2 for each upgrade, so if you put 2 in here, it'll only increase the reload speed by +4, which isn't really that much. The best thing in this tree is probably the Gambit, which out of all the abilities is the best of them all. When you hit this ability, it'll increase the morale, attack, and reload of all units in your army, which is a lot better than the Heroic Assault. I mean, this one's pretty good, but the rest of the abilities are just really weak. Pretty much you're making your gun, your bodyguard a gun unit. Range will increase its range to, I think, 200, which it can come in really handy, actually, when you're microing. But it's not as good as the other trees. But if you do upgrade it, you know, obviously get range, and I would go all the way up and get Gambat. You know, reload line infantry, you know, extra ammo for some stuff. But generally, I'd steer away from a full gun tree, although I have seen some people use it effectively. If you do it, you know, it's more micro intensive. You know, you're utilizing your gun gen pretty much, and taking advantage of his extra range, and you've got that Gambat ability, which is pretty good, but that's really all you got besides your buffed up general, your buffed up gun gen. You can do a hybrid, and when you do a hybrid, pretty much what I work up towards is the cavalry capture in the Bushido tree. So you got the cav capture, so now I can capture dojos with my mounted cavalry. And I also want to work up towards improving the aura radius of my general. And I also want to improve the aura radius of my elite units. And then I want to give my general a gun. And I want to improve its reload and its accuracy. So this is a good hybrid I like to use sometimes. I can capture dojos with cavalry. My general and my elite units have increased aura radius. And my gen himself has the best of this tree, pretty much, as far as improving the general stats itself. You know, it's got the gun, it's got the reload and the accuracy bonus. So you can use them sort of maybe in combination with some Imperial Guard or some Revolver Cav, and you can use its gun abilities. This is a good hybrid to use, probably the best hybrid you can use. There's other types of hybrids you could use, but I wouldn't even use hybrids, period. I would go full Bushido or full Command or use a hybrid like this. Those are probably your best bets. So let's go now into how to upgrade your veteran units. Well, let's first discuss the available units, period. You've got let's go over the line infantry first. The best line infantry units would be, the Black Bears and the White Bears. The difference between the Bear units is the Black Bear has 5 extra reload and 5 extra accuracy than the White Bear, which has, you know, 5 less reload and accuracy, but it has extra, 1 extra attack and 1 extra defense, and it costs 50 less. I've noticed most people prefer the White Bears. Personally, I prefer the Black Bears. But either of them, really, they're both, pretty good. Black Bears or White Bears, it's probably the best medium cost gun unit. Red Bears, you know, they're probably the least good of the Bears. You know, they got the most, you know, they got a lot more attack and charge and a lot less reload and accuracy. And they cost the same as a White Bear. You're best off using Black or White Bears, though. Now, if you want an even cheaper gun unit, you're best off using, where are they? You're best off using Black Tortoise Force. They got really weak morale, and, you know, this is good, though, for a good, cheap unit. They're still a full 150 unit strength. It's good for a really cheap gun unit. Now, if you want an elite gun unit, I would use the Marine units, the Infantry to Marine, Royal Marine, and United States Marine. I would gear away from using, you know, Shogunate Guard Infantry or Imperial Guard Infantry or some of the more elite units from here, like Imperial Infantry. They're just too expensive for their worth. Although, you know, Shogunate Guard Infantry and Imperial Guard Infantry have that aura radius around them. If you want that aura radius and an elite unit in general, you're better off just using your Marines. So the only feasible, you know, useful gun units, you can use Vermilion Bird Force, which is pretty much the same thing as a Black Bear, except, where is it at? It has extra morale. It has a lot better morale. So it's pretty much the same thing as, like, the Black Bears, except it has a lot more morale. And a little bit an extra attack and defense as well. But as far as gun units go, the best for their money, Black Bears. White Bears, Black Tortoise. And to some extent, maybe Vermilion Bird Force. I would steer away from everything else. I would steer away from using these units as well. Now, as far as your melee infantry is concerned, your best bet is using Shogatai. They're the best sword unit for their cost. If you look at the next best unit, Katanakachi, look at the difference. For an extra 100, look how much extra you get. The morale's the main killer right there. An extra 8 morale to 12 morale is a huge difference. The only reason I would use Katanakachi is, let's say you want a whole bunch of melee infantry. You can only take 3 Shogatai. So the only reason I would take Katanakachi is if I want even more melee infantry. Then I would take some Katanakachi. But otherwise, I would use Shogatai over Katanakachi. Always. Always. The Kisho Ninja, they're not as good as the ninjas from Shogun 2. You don't need to use a retainer for them, though. I keep one veteran ninja, and I'll throw it in my army sometimes. You know, it helps catch them off guard. Like, maybe if I want a double team. Like, I use it occasionally. Not really that good, though. It's not worth its money. Although, you know, I occasionally will use a Kisho Ninja unit. And I'll usually deploy it behind my enemy, and I'll come up behind him, and I'll use it to, you know, throw into a cav fight on the side, or, you know, try to get in for a flank behind him when I've engaged my enemy. I get my use from it sometimes, but you're best off steering away from the Kisho Ninjas, and you're best off steering away from the Yarikachi and the Kyoto Police. They're just not that good. They're good. Theoretically, you'd use them against cavalry, but that's not going to happen in too many situations. I would steer away from the spear levies, too. The only reason you'd use a spear levy is maybe if you need a fodder unit, but unlike in Shogun 2, where they had the attendants for like 150 apiece, you're spending $420 for a fodder unit. That's pretty much half the cost of a good unit. You know, all the good units I was just going over cost $800, $900. This is half that. So if I just take 2 fodder units, I could have got 1 good unit. I mean, if you want a fodder unit, why not use Black Tortoise? For an extra $200, you'll have a fodder unit that can actually fire back at your enemy. So I'm not a big fan of using spear levies as fodder. Although, if you're using a rush build and you, like, you know, you need a fodder unit to take up that first volley or two, you could use this, but I would generally steer away from it. Yeah, just take the damage on your elite, your better units, because that fodder unit is, it's not really fodder when it costs so darn much. I mean, a fodder unit, I would consider something a lot cheaper than this, like, you know, the attendants from Shogun 2. This is just too expensive to be fodder. It's just taking too much away from your army in general if you're going to use that as a fodder unit. I would use maybe spear levies. If you're looking for a spear to throw into the cav fight, I'd maybe use a spear levy for that purpose. That's the only reason I would use a spear levy, though. I wouldn't really use it as a fodder. If I had, like, maybe an extra 400 I couldn't spend anywhere else, then I would take a spear levy. That's the only reason I would use spear levies, though. Let's quick go over the skirmish and the elite infantry. I wouldn't use any of these. They're not good. Theoretically, the Yugatais, it's an interesting unit. It can fire while it's hidden. You know, it can fire while it's hidden in woods, and it can, it's a Kisho unit. You can deploy it outside of your deployment zone. It's just a small unit, though. It's about half this, you know, it's 90 men in its unit, whereas other units have 150, and its stats are not that good, especially not for its price, which is 1500 for a vanilla version of it. It is an interesting unit, though. It has interesting abilities. Kisho ability, and it can fire while hidden. I mean, if you use it often enough, I'm sure you'll play some games where it, like, comes in super handy, like, you know, some cav gets in range of it while it's hidden unsuspectingly, and then it kills like half the enemy's cav, and then your cav goes in to finish it off. I mean, in some circumstances, I'm sure you get your worth from it, but in the majority of the games you play, you probably would not get your worth from this unit. It is interesting, though, in the options there. If you're looking for a fun unit to use, maybe use the Yugatai. The other unit you could possibly consider is the Tosa Riflemen, because of their extra range. You could work up to get 175 range, and then you'll have the longest range gun unit, and you'll always get that first volley off. But again, it's only 90 men in the unit. It's so darn expensive, and its stats, I mean, the stats of a Tosa, I suppose, are a bit better than the Yugatai, but they're still not that good when compared to other units at a lot cheaper cost. Everything else here, I wouldn't really use. Artillery, if you're going to use artillery, I would use an Armstrong artillery piece, and you would benefit from upgrading it with extra reload and accuracy. I'll show you that when I go over the veteran units. As far as your cavalry, the best cavalry units you can use for, okay, let's, for melee cavalry, you're best just using Yariki cavalry, and I'll go over how to upgrade them then. If you need one even more cavalry, you can then use Shogunate Guard Cav. Your best cavalry unit for the price, though, is Yariki. The next best melee cav would be Shogunate Guard. I would steer away from Saber Cav. I mean, you can use them against gun units or enemy sword units, but they're just not worth it. You can't use them against enemy cav. I mean, it's maybe as an extra, you know, cheap unit. I would steer away from them, though. I'd use, for melee cav, Yariki and Shogunate Guard. Now, for gun cav, do not use carbine cavalry. If you're going to use gun cav, use either Imperial Guard cav or Revolver cav. Imperial Guard have decentish melee stats. You can actually use them in melee as well. I wouldn't put it up against other enemy cav, though, but you can use it against enemy swords and gun units in melee, or use it to flank. Revolver cav, on the other hand, you can't tell from its stats. You look at it like, wow, that's a pretty crappy unit. It's actually a pretty good unit. They fire so darn quickly. Like, in a short period of time, they can just decimate a large amount of enemy units. It takes a lot of micro to use them well, and I mean, you can get your worth from them. They have really short range, but they fire quickly. It's pretty much like a double pistol. So each hand is a pistol, a revolver pistol, and imagine just, you know, boom, 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 reload. Boom, 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 reload. Yeah, you just picture double pistols. They get a lot of shots off in a short period of time, but short range, and they're not good in melee. So those are your two options for missile cav, if you like using them. Now let's go over how to upgrade your veteran units. As far as upgrading your cavalry, let's go over the Yariki cav. When you upgrade Yariki, this is one of those units, you actually benefit from upgrading them a whole lot. Well, first, the charge, why is this only have Oh, okay, never mind. I was looking at a different one. Okay. Here's something that I learned while I was in agony from Duck. Units do not benefit from more than 20 charge. If the unit already has 20 charge or more than 20 charge, do not upgrade it with extra charge. It won't benefit from it. If it has less than 20 charge, you can upgrade it until it has 20 charge. So, for example, Yariki has 15 charge. You put up one upgrade in charge, it'll give it 20 charge, which is the perfect number for charge on any unit. So you can put that one in charge, and then beyond that, you want to put it in attack and defense. And then you want to use clan tokens to upgrade it with even more attack. You can upgrade it with morale as well, because it has weak morale. I'm sort of questioning whether I should have upgraded my Yari Ki with morale, though, because think about it, if you use four Yari Ki in your army with two morale upgrades on each of them, that's an extra $400 you're spending, and I feel confident enough that I can control the unit and not put it into those sticky situations where that extra morale would help, and it's just two morale. It's like, I don't know. I'm going to say you're best off upgrading these units fully: attack, defense, charge. Two attack, two defense, one charge, two morale, and two clan upgraded melee attack for a full level 9 Yari Ki cavalry. I think that's a great way to upgrade it. Or if you're going for cost effectiveness, you can just put two in melee attack and leave it at that. Or two in melee attack and two in melee defense and leave it at that. Or two attack, two defense, and one charge and leave it at that. Those would be the cost effective ways to upgrade it. This would be the best full way to upgrade it to level 9. Now, Shogun at Guard Cav is a good cavalry unit as well. I would use Yari Ki over it, though, because if you look at this, is a Yari Ki. Look at the stats. Now, look at it costs 1180. Now, a vanilla Shogun at Guard Cav costs 1200. So, compare these stats right here to a Shogun at Guard at the same price. They're not as good. Shogun at Guard has a bit extra morale and a bit more charge, but again, like I said, more than 20 charge, kind of useless. So, a fully upgraded Yari Ki is better than a vanilla Shogun at Guard at the same price. Although a Shogun at Guard does have that elite aura radius. But if you're going to use Shogun at Guard, I would upgrade it, and I think the best way to upgrade it, the best full way to upgrade it would be 2 attack, 2 defense, and 2 clan upgraded attack. Or if you want a more cost effective way to upgrade it, I would just do 2 attack, or 2 attack and 2 defense. But the best full way to upgrade it: 2 attack, 2 defense, 2 clan upgraded attack, and leave it at that. Don't upgrade anything else. Now, as far as your gun cavalry, I think you're better off just using it vanilla. You know, the Imperial and the Revolver Cav I discussed, don't put any upgrades on them, because when you upgrade their accuracy and reload, it only gives you +5, which isn't really worth that 50 for each upgrade. A lot of units, they'll gain +10, which might be worth it then, but if you're only getting +5 for an upgrade, it's not really worth it, in my opinion. And both of these are those units where you only get +5 reload for each, you know, reload upgrade, and, you know, same with accuracy. So I think they're best off use just vanilla. Although, you can use veteran versions of him with just one reload upgrade, because what happens when you turn a unit into a veteran, it actually gains a fatigue resistance bonus. So you actually benefit from just you upgrading a unit with just, you know, one upgrade, which is why I'll go right into the line infantry. Explain how to upgrade line infantry, and which will also, when I discuss the Black Tortoise, explain the reasoning with that. Look how I upgrade my Black Tortoise. I only have one upgrade, which is in reload speed, because when I use a Black Tortoise, I'm using it for the purpose of being a cost-efficient, cheap unit. But I just give it one upgrade in reload, that way it gets that fatigue resistance bonus. So it gets, you know, an extra 10 reload, and it gets that fatigue resistance bonus. I'm just turning into a veteran to get that fatigue resistance bonus, get a little extra reload speed, and, you know, I'm not putting any more upgrades on it because I'm keeping it cost efficient, but I do want to get that fatigue resistance bonus on it. So that's how I upgrade my Black Tortoise, for cost efficiencies. Now, if you're going to upgrade Black Bears, I think the best way to upgrade it is just 2 reload. get that extra 20 reload and just leave it at that right there. Don't do anything else. If you want to upgrade it further, I would put it in an accuracy. But I wouldn't upgrade it further. You can actually upgrade this to level 9 and put extended range. I would not suggest doing that though. Although you'll see it is kind of common. Some people do it. I would not suggest doing that. Because what you can do is, and it's for the black bears, it's the same way. Upgrade the white bears the same way as well. I don't have any vermilion bird force to show you how to upgrade that unit, but it is a decent unit you can use. If I used it, I would probably just do 2 reload speed, probably, and just leave it at that, the same way I upgrade the black bears. Now, for your marine units, these are one of those interesting units, because remember how I said if it only gets plus 5 for each reload and accuracy upgrade, I wouldn't really put any more on it. Marines are one of those ones, they only gain plus 5 for each, you know, reload upgrade and accuracy upgrade. But unlike other units where you need to get it to level 9 in order to unlock increased range becomes available after level 4. So when it's level 5 for the 5th upgrade, you can do increased range. So you would actually benefit from upgrading your marines to level 5. I would do 2 reload speed, 2 accuracy, and increased range. Or what you can do is 2 reload, 1 accuracy, 1 defense, and increased range. I do this only because, you know, it already has so much accuracy, and putting another point in accuracy would only give it 5 more. Whereas if I did a defense upgrade, I could, you know, give it some extra defense in case it gets charged by cav or infantry. So, you know, I would suggest reload accuracy, increased range, although you could do what I did, reload, 1 accuracy, 1 defense, and increased range. I wouldn't upgrade it any further than that, though. And that goes for all 3 of your marine units. Let's see if there's, okay, oh yeah, there's this, the infantry units. Remember what I said, Shogatai, the best infantry unit? When you upgrade your Shogatai, I would just do 2 attack, and I wouldn't upgrade anything else. Keep it cost efficient. The more, the better. You can afford more of everything then. But if you want to upgrade it even further than this, what I would suggest doing then is 2 attack, 1 defense, 1 morale, which will then unlock the clan upgrades, and then you can put 2 more in attack. So if you want to upgrade it further, I would do 2 attack, 1 morale, 1 defense, 2 clan upgraded attack. And then I would leave it at that. But for cost efficiency, I would just do 2 attack. Now, for your Katanakachi, again, I would not use Katanakachi unless you've already maxed out all 3 of your Shogatai and you want, like, you know, an extra melee unit. Then that's the only reason I would use Katanakachi. And what I would suggest doing for your Katanakachi, for cost efficiency, again, I would just do 2 attack and 1 morale. I would put an upgrade in morale because it has such weak morale that it would definitely benefit from that morale upgrade. And I would go even further for your Katanakachi because it's pretty much like a 4th sword or 4th or 5th sword unit. You know, you maxed out on your Shogatai, you bring in another Katanakachi. You want to make it, you know, comparable to your Shogatai, so I would upgrade it 2 attack, 1 morale, 1 defense, and 1 clan upgraded morale, and then I would leave it at that, because that extra morale will help it stick in the fight with the Shogatai. If you want it upgraded even further, you could do a defense, 2 attack, 1 morale, 1 clan upgraded morale, and 2 clan upgraded attack. I would just leave it, for cost efficiency though, I would just do 2 attack, 1 morale, and leave it at that. Which is pretty much, I think, how this one's upgraded. So this is the cost-efficient way to upgrade it. This is the probably more expensive way to upgrade it. And you can even make it more expensive and add some clan upgraded attack if you want. Again, like I said, the spears, I would stay away from them. Unless you want to use it to throw into the spear fight, then just use a vanilla spear levy or something. Again, cost efficiencies. Although if you want, I guess you could upgrade your spear levies, just, you know, get a veteran of it with just like a morale upgrade and then leave it at that, so it gets the fatigue gain and, you know, it's still cost efficient. Now your artillery pieces, I would steer away from all their artillery, except maybe if you're going to take an artillery piece, I would maybe bring an Armstrong gun. And when you upgrade it, I would upgrade it fully with extra reload and extra accuracy, and then I would leave it at that. Upgrade nothing else except basic reload and basic accuracy. And that is pretty much the gist of upgrading units. Let's see, I went over the skill tree, went over the retainers, I went over the units, I went over the veteran units. That is pretty much the gist of all the advanced topics, really. If you have any questions at all, just post a comment and I'll do my best to answer. As far as using the units in battles, you can watch all my other videos to, you know, show you how to actually use the units on the battlefield in a competent army build. You can use my regular videos to show how to build, you know, good armies, different, you know, units you can use together in a competent army, and, you know, how to use it on the battlefield. You can watch my regular videos for that. But besides that, this pretty much covers all the advanced topics. I really hope it helped you out at all. I mean, I really hope it helped you out, and if you have any questions at all, post a comment and I'll do my best to answer them for you. And that is that. Thank you for watching if you stuck with me this far.